Hello and welcome to our special interview this week. My name is Viola Xasia and as always, we are going to talk about events highlighting business this week, and joining me is Paul Busharizi, who is a business editor and journalist with The New Vision. Thank you so much, Paul, for joining us. And let's start off with the NSSF. It's selling like a hotcake, conversations about it this week. So savers who are currently standing at 1.3 million, a couple of them think that money is being misused in the NSSF, allegedly. And so I would love to hear what you think. And having been following the news, what do you think is causing this rumor and how can we shut it down? Does it hold water or not?
Well, I think that there are processes within NSSF, and hopefully, you know, this shakeup is not going to cause much disruption. That IGG has, for example, put a hold on certain big procurements. So if there's anything doubtful about these procurements, it's probably not going to happen in the next few weeks or so. So I tend to believe the minister that the money is safe. We should be concerned about the running of NSSF. We should be concerned that it's run properly, because for many of us workers, we have saved there for a long time, and we need to get paid at the end of a certain period. NSSF, of course, is unique in the sense that even if we were scared, we can't run there and withdraw our money. So it's important for us as workers to ensure that it's going properly. So we should be concerned. We shouldn't just relax at the current developments.
There have been several questions as well concerning NSSF and the processes that go on in there. And Mr. Biarugaba is going to be 60 years, so a lot of people are concerned about getting him out, even though he's still delivering results. So do you think the issue should always be about age, or should we just focus on results of a person and let them perform?
I think that the age, first of all, some of these age limits or age ceilings were set when, for example, the life expectancy in Uganda in 1986 was about 49 years. So it was thought that if somebody was 60, is very, very old, and you know he can't operate. So I think as a ad hoc figure, it doesn't say much about the person in the job. But I think his record over the time he's been in NSSF seems to be, he's produced results. So we should be judging him against his results. Therefore, whether they should extend or not should really be about whether he's performed or not over the time he's been there.
And Paul, finally, with the NSSF, we did have an incident in the lockdown where people wanted to get midterm access for their money. And I understand there was, there was a petition back then to have midterm access and then final access of the savers' money. What do you think about this kind of thing where people need to get their money before or get it at the end? Also, there is a question about what if I die? What if I never get my money? So what do you say to Ugandans who are saving but almost against their will?
Well, first of all, about the COVID money, I mean, the law just wouldn't allow it. So they had to go, we had to go into an amendment of the law, which actually the process had begun even before COVID. So the amendment of the law to allow, for example, midterm access didn't come because of COVID. It had been thought of previously. Secondly, of course, that's how the law is written, that we can't get out our money anytime we want. There are stipulated times when you can access our money, and that's how it should be, because these are supposed to be long-term savings. Should we wonder whether the money is safe or not, given we're keeping there for so long? As I said earlier, that we should be concerned in what happens at the fund, NSSF. And we should be watching them, and we should be putting them under the microscope to ensure they are doing things as well as they can. So even this hullabaloo is useful for the rest of us workers to understand actually what's going on in NSSF and whether it's to our liking. And if need be, something should be changed.
Thank you very much for that clarity regarding NSSF. So let's now move on to the president's visit to the Middle East, in particular Abu Dhabi. So we did see that he had a bit of, you know, things to talk about regarding the economy, environment, going green, moving into the future as the world. And so I'm intrigued to ask you what Ugandans can focus on when it comes to the Middle East and in terms of market as business people.
Of course, the president, whenever he goes places, he's normally pitching for more business, more investment and stuff like that. We know Abu Dhabi is the biggest producer of oil in the Emirates, in the United Arab Emirates, and therefore it could be attractive as a source of investment to Uganda. So that's one thing I'm sure he was going for. Secondly, it can provide market for our stuff. The challenge for us, of course, is to produce stuff to the volumes that will make those markets pay attention to us. Story is told a few years ago of how the president got a contract, or not a contract, but it was suggested to him that Iran would take 14,000 goods a week from Uganda, and we failed to meet that contract. So. Whether we get into business, meaningful business with Abu Dhabi or what, is whether we can produce to meet their demand.
Thank you very much, Paul, for making time for this interview, and we shall hear from you next time. And thank you, dear viewer, for making time to watch this special interview here on Urban TV. We do discuss business events happening throughout the week, and we shall see you next time. Back to the news.